Dear students, as part of the paper on population theories, this module focuses on the population trends by world and also by some of these countries, both developed and developing countries.
Major learning objective is to get to know about population trends in the world and some of the countries, both developed and developing, and major key indicators of population and other characteristics. A set of countries and their data have been given for each indicator, which are expected to depict a broader range of these indicators. However, the selection of countries and also to draw appropriate conclusions and from the each countries are very important for us to understand. Let's focus on population size and growth. The population size and its growth, which have been presented in the table for the years 1950, 2017 and projected figures of 2030 and given in terms of thousands. Some countries with different population sizes over a range are given in the table and their growth can be traced accordingly. In 2017, for instance, we see that the population size of Namibia was in thousands 2534, while it was 104918 for the Philippines, 28834 for Ghana, 209288 for Brazil, and 1339180 in thousands for India. It can be seen that the size of population for all the countries in the table as shown have grown over the time period between 1950 and 2017, although the extent to which growth has taken place differs considerably across countries. Growth is also projected for many of these countries for the year 2030, although this is not universally true for all countries across the world. Many countries in Europe are expected to have a decline in population size due to a decline in the total fertility rate and due to the population aging, amongst other factors. Looking at the table above, we can see that the population size as depicted in thousands of Cyprus increased from 494 thousands in 1950 to 1180 thousands in 2017, and the projection for 2030 is only a marginal increase to 1282 thousands. On the other hand, we see that the extent of growth has been larger with regard to the other countries such as Philippines, and in the case of India, the growth has been from 376325 in thousands in 1950 to 1339180 in thousands in 2017 and 1512985 in thousands in the year 2030. On the other hand, for Spain, while the population size increased between 1950 2013, the projection for 2030 is that the population size will be around the same or decline slightly. Other countries in Europe and in some countries in Asia as well may be expected to decline in size to a greater extent during the reference period. Further research can be done by referring to country data, the sources as given below in the table, and also at the references cited in the at the end. Let's focus on the indicator of urbanization, that is percent of urban, which represents out of the percent of total population during 1960 to 2016 across different countries. These countries, when it is analyzed, which will show a broad comparison over time for the percent of urban population out of the total population. For example, we see that Singapore has been 100% urban in 1960 and also in 2016, while Switzerland was 51% urban in 1960, which increased to 74% in 2016, and the US from 70% in 1960 to 82% of the total population in urban in 2016, and Brazil from 46% to a much larger figure of 86% in 2016. On the other hand, we see a much smaller percent urban in other countries, both in 1960 and in 2016, as with countries like Burundi from 2% in 1960 to 12% in 2016, and for India from 18% urban to as high as 33% in 2016. These figures, however, do not tell us whether the change in percent of urban over time is good or bad, for which further analysis will have to be carried out with regard to these figures as percent of urban with respect to larger population, as well as with regard to other concerns such as environmental issues. Let's focus on the net migration. Some of these countries during the period 1962 and 2012. The data on net migration, as depicted in the table 3, for some countries in 1962 and 2012 can be compared, wherein the negative figures indicate more migrants leaving the country, that is emigration, than entering the country, which is immigration. While positive figures indicate that there are more migrants entering the country, that is immigration, than leaving the country, that is emigration. At times, there may not be data availability for different reasons. For instance, in the table above, we can see that Honduras had positive net migration in 1962, that's to the extent of 11,000, but this became a negative net migration of 80,000 in 2012. On the other hand, Turkey had a negative net migration in 1962 of 259,169, but in 2012, there was a positive net migration of to the extent of 200,003, indicating that in 2012, there were more migrants entering the country than leaving the country. For Costa Rica, the positive net migration increased from 7905 to 19658 between 1962 and 2012, and for the United Kingdom from 142563 to 900000 in that same period. For Sri Lanka, the negative net migration increased from 47,500 in 1962 to 484772 in 2012. Let's discuss about the issues related to fertility. For instance, the measurement crude birth rate as indicated for various countries during the periods 1960 and 2015. When we analyze, these crude birth rates for some countries are given for 1960 and 2015 expressed per 1000 population. For all these countries, the crude birth rate has declined over this period, although the extent of decline has varied across these countries. For instance, in Kuwait, the crude birth rate was as high as 41 in 1960 and it declined to only 20 in 2015. And for country like India, which had a high crude birth rate as high as 42, has come down to around 20 over the same period. For Chad, the extent of decline was much smaller, from 46 in 1950 to 45 in 2015. Similarly, the measurement on total fertility rate, that is number of live births per woman during the period 1975 to 1980 up to the projected period of 2025 to 2030 across these countries, clearly reveals the contrasting levels. For example, the total fertility rate is given for some countries over the period and projected for all these countries in the table. There has been a steady declining trend in the total fertility rate over time, although the steepness of the decline varies considerably across these countries. For some countries, there is projected to be a slight increase in the total fertility rate during the period 2025 to 2030. Often, these are the more industrialized countries where there is a problem of low fertility rates and active programmatic efforts are being taken to increase the fertility levels to a great extent of its reduction, in contrast to other countries where programs work towards lowering the fertility rate. In Colombia, for instance, the total fertility rate was 4.25 in 1975 to 80, which declined to only 1.93 in 2010 to 2015, and it is further projected to decline further to only 1.69 in 2025 to 2030. For a country like Oman, the total fertility rate was as high as 8.10 in 1975 to 1980, which declined to 2.54 in 2010 to 2015, and further projected to decline to 1.74 in 2025 to 2030. Singapore had a very low fertility rate even in 1975 to 1980 of only TFR of 1.84, which declined further to only 1.23 in 2010-2015, but it is projected to slightly increase to 1.30 in 2025-2030. Sweden, for instance, as well shows a slight increasing trend over a period of time, that is TFR of 1.66 in 1975-1980 to 1.90 in 2010-2015, although there was a slight decrease between 1990-95 to 2005-2010, and the projection is that it will further increase to 1.92 between 2025-2030. India's total fertility rate, which was as high as 4.97 in 1975-1980, has declined considerably to 2.44 between 2010-2015, and further it is expected to decline to as low as 2.10 between 2025-2030. Let's focus on the other component, that is mortality, which is measured through crude death rates. For the periods 1960 and 2015 across different countries, when we analyze the crude death rate, there is a variations that have been noticed. For most countries, there has been a significant decline. For instance, Angola, the crude death rate has declined from 32 in 1960 to only 13 in 2015, and Guatemala from 19 in 1960 to only 5 in 2015. For a country like India, which had crude death rate of 22, has come down to 7, and for Luxembourg from crude death rate of 12 to crude death rate of only 7 over the same period. In Netherlands, the crude death rate has had a slight increase between 1960 and the data of 2015, that is from 8 to 9, the level of crude death rate. Thus, we see that the crude death rates vary by country, and the pace of decline also varies across these countries. However, some commonalities also may be observed amongst the developed countries and among the developing countries, although there is also regional variations within these countries. Let's focus on the life expectancy at birth, which is widely seen across these reference periods for these countries which have been focused. The data on life expectancy at birth in years is given for different countries in the table over a period of time, that is from 1990 to 1995 to 2010-2015 and projected to 2025 to 2030. The analysis shows clearly that for all countries, the life expectancy at birth has generally been in increasing trend, although the range even in 2010 to 2015 varies significantly across countries, with Niger, for example, having a life expectancy of only 58.5 years, Thailand as high as 74.6 years, and Austria as high as 81 years. Over time, looking at each country, we can see that Fiji had a life expectancy of 66.1 in 1990-95, which increased to 69.7 in 2010-2015, and further it is projected to increase to 71.9 in 2025-2030. Coming to India, which had a life expectancy of only 59.2 years in 1990 to 95, increased to 67.6 years during the period 2010-2015, and the projection shows clearly that the life expectancy is going to increase to as high as 71 in 2025 to 2030. Malawi, for instance, which had a life expectancy of only 46.7 years in 90 to 95 and has increased to 60.7 years in 2010-2015, and it is projected to increase to as high as 67.8 years in 2025 to 2030. Let's focus on mortality, especially when we talk about the early childhood mortality, that is under 5 mortality rate. That period of 1990 to 95 to projected years of 2025 to 2030 across these countries. The under 5 mortality rate expressed per 1000 of live births, which is given in the table for different countries for the reference period and also to projected to 2025 to 2030, clearly indicate that the data for the different countries, the under 5 mortality rate has a considerable range even in the period of 1990 to 95, although this range has steeply declined in 2010 to 2015 and is further projected to decline considerably in 2025 to 30. As the mortality rates for this age group declines for all these countries under reference. In Bangladesh, Cambodia, India and Congo, the under 5 mortality rate was above 100 in 1990 to 95, which has declined considerably looking at the data in 2010 to 2015 and further below 70, with Bangladesh around 41.3, Cambodia around 34.9, India at 52.5 and Congo at 67.2. The projections for the period 2025 to 2030 for these countries is even lower, at 22.2 for Bangladesh, Cambodia 14.3, Congo 41.9 and India 32.3. For country Mauritius, we see that during 1990 to 95, there was a relatively low under 5 mortality rate to the extent of 21.2, which declined to 14.2 in 2010 to 2015, and the projection shows that by 2025 to 2030, the under 5 mortality is going to be as low as 9.6. For New Zealand, it was 9.1 in 1990 to 95, as low as 5.3 it has come down during 2010 to 2015, and it is further projected to decline to only 3.8 in 2025 to 2030. Let's discuss about the other major component, that is population aging, which is expressed through the indicator median age. For the periods 1950, 80, 2015, 2030, for some of the selected countries, the median age, which is expressed in years for varied countries for these periods, clearly gives a varied picture. This median age, which is the age at which there is exactly half the population on either side of the age, an older median age is generally indicative of population aging. The data in the table clearly reveals that the median age as a whole, which has been shifting over time towards higher ages for all these countries, although some of these countries have median ages that are relatively younger, while other countries have median ages which are relatively older. A number of factors influences the median age of the population. For example, we see that for Jordan and Pakistan, the median age was 17.2 years and 19.8 years respectively in 1950, which increased to 22.5 years, and for both in 2015 and the figure projected for 2030, which is an increase to 26.3 years and 25.5 years for Jordan and Pakistan respectively. Slightly higher median ages is reported for countries like Belgium and the United States, which was 35.5 years and 30.0 respectively in 1950, which increased further to 41.5 years and 38.0 years in 2015, and the projections clearly increase that it's going to increase further to 43.6 years for Belgium and 40.0 years for the United States. The median age for India, when we talk about, is with as close as to Cuba, which is to the extent of 21 and 22 years in 1950, while it is increased considerably for Cuba to 41.2 years. In the case of India, it was only 26.6 years in 2015, and the projections for both these countries by 2030 indicates that the median age is going to be as high as 46.4 years for Cuba, while for India it is going to be only 31.2 years. Let us focus on the other indicator, like age structure. Age structure broadly presented in children's with respect to 0 to 14 years and working age with respect to 15 to 64 years and the elderly of 65 plus across these countries over a period of time clearly reveals a wide variations among these countries over a period of time. The above table thus shows that the proportion of population amongst the different age groups of 0 to 14, 15 to 64 and 65 plus for these countries. For instance, in the UK, we see that in 1950, the proportion of children was 11,366, which actually declined to 10,773 in 2010, but it is further projected to increase to 12,170 by 2030. Much of the population in 1950 was in the middle age bracket of 15 to 64 years, and it has clearly shown that it is going to increase for this age group. The proportion of older persons, which was 5,483 in 1950, which increased to 10,290 in 2010 and is expected to further increase to as high as 14,634 in 2030. In Portugal, for instance, we see that the proportion of population was 2,491 in 1950 for the child population, that is 0 to 14 years of age group, which declined to 1,614 in 2010 and which is going to be further decreased to 1,224 in 2030. The middle age bracket was 5,337 in 1950, which increased to 7,147 in 2010 and further expected to be 6,483 in 2030. The proportion of older persons in Portugal in 1950 was as high as 590, which has increased to 2010 and it is projected to be further to 2602 in the year 2030. For Sudan, we see that the proportion of population has been shifting amongst the age groups over time. In 1950, the 0 to 14 age group and the 15 to 64 age group was 4025 and 4859 respectively, and the proportion of older persons was 306. In 2010, while proportion in all age groups increased, the gap between 0 to 14 age group and 15 to 64 age group has widened with 17,459 and 24,540 respectively, and the proportion of 65 was also to the great extent has increased. In India, in 1950, the figures for the different age groups were 139,387 in the 0 to 40 age group, 220,804 in the middle age group and 11,666 for 65 age group. In 2010, we see that the figures further went to increase to the extent of 374,587 in 0 to 14 years. In 15 to 64 years, it is going to be 789,750 and further 24,893 for the older age group. The projections for 2030 clearly reveals that the figures are going to be further increased to 363,151 of 0 to 14 age group and 15 to 64 is going to be 1,034,326 and to 1,260,006 for the older age group of 65 plus. In the figure given below, we can see how the proportion of older persons has been increasing over time for different countries. Particularly striking is for India. Let us focus on the other important indicator of economic angle of dependence ratios, which is usually expressed per 100 working age persons. For the most of these countries across different points of time, when the data is analyzed, the dependence ratios per 100 working age persons for some of these countries which are expressed in terms of total dependence ratio the child dependence ratio and the old age dependence ratio over these periods. For Botswana, we see that in 1950, the total dependence ratio, which is expressed per 100 working age persons, was as high as 83. The child dependence ratio was 75, and the old age dependence ratio was only 8 per 100 working age persons. It is in 2010, there increased to 58 for the total dependence ratio, 51 for child dependence ratio, and 6 for the old age dependence ratio. The projections for Botswana in 2030 is that it will further decline for all the three to 51 for the total dependence ratio, 41 for the child dependence ratio, and 9 for the old age dependence ratio. For a country like India, in 1950, the total dependence ratio was 68, the child dependence ratio was 63, and the old age dependence ratio was 5 per 100 working age persons. In 2010, the total dependence ratio declined to 55, the child dependence ratio declined to 47, while the old age dependence ratio increased to 8. For Norway, which is a developed country, the total dependence ratio in 1950 was 52, the child dependence ratio was 37, and the old age dependence ratio was 15. In 2010, we see that Norway's total dependence ratio declined slightly to 50, the child dependence ratio declined to 28, while the old age dependence ratio increased to 22. The projected for 2030 clearly reveals that in Norway, the total dependence ratio is going to increase to 64, the child dependence ratio will increase slightly to 30, while the old age dependence ratio will increase to 34. Given below, the figures for old age dependence ratio clearly reveals over the period that for both old age dependence ratios are going to be increased over the period. For both India and Norway, old age dependence ratio, that is per 100 working age persons, is steadily increasing and projected to increase still further over the period of under the reference period. In summary, in this module, we would have come to learn some of the key indicators and the major population trends over a period of time with some of the specific countries. The country data should give an idea of the range of figures across regions, although no specific conclusions can be drawn regarding regional commonalities and differences. However, each of the countries depicts their clear-cut specific levels of these measurements, and also it gives a clarity about understanding the levels of development of these countries with reference to various population parameters. The module interprets some of the data for countries drawn from United Nations manuals, and it is expected to give a picture of the trends in these indicators for some countries over a period of time.